We are going to take a topic that was obsolete for several centuries and that was only available as a product of esoteric lineage. It was just taught only from the preceptor and the disciple lineage, that too with lot of stipulations and under intensive, crucial and intimate coachings, methodologies by which the disciples are forwarded to a hermitage and by proper testing, that too at the age of their impressionable adaptability, they went on for a vigorous training. So such a type of that is what we call esoteric. That which is available only to few on basis of various conditions, only that can be departed through a selective member or a selective group of people in the society. So that type of rigidity has been made flexible by the process of the liberalization of wisdom by translations and transliterations. Now you see lot of scriptures available in Sanskrit regarding the Yoga Samhitas, like the Patanjala Sutra or the Vyasa Bhashya or the Garanda Samhita or Yoga Chintamani. All of these treatises, they are available with Hindi translation. The original books, their commentaries and the elucidatory articles and their innovative and annotative studies, everything that is available not only in Hindi and other regional languages but also in English, French and German. So the process of the era of liberalization of wisdom has made all treatises. It is simultaneously a blessing and as well as a curse. The blessing is that the source materials of the system of knowledge is available in all languages at all places. Now readily by spending 50 or 100 rupees you can easily purchase the Yoga Sutra and its Bhashya, that too in your regional language. But before few centuries, for learning that Yoga Sutra, you have to take a preliminary requisite or eligibility being celibacy and then practicing lot of rituals or austerity and penance, everything etc. You have to undergo a vigorous intimate training under the tutelage of an efficient realized master. To get the details of this yoga, it would have taken at least a decade for you, but with depth and density and gravity. So the blessing of the modern era of liberalization is you can get the contents, but the curse is you cannot get the depth and density and gravity of knowledge which we used to get on those areas. So now the body of knowledge, the physical structure of knowledge, is readily available in the form of book material, oral discourses, conferences and workshops, as well as in the form of even that is the www world wide web, in which you have all resources and sources for anything that is available, whether that is digestible or indigestible, reliable or unreliable. All things that is exist that dwells in the society in the form of knowledge, whether that is a skeptic, insufficient, sufficient, inefficient, efficient, irrespective of their status of reliability and the resplendence, everything is available. Whatever I know, whatever I think that I know, immediately that is published in the net and it is available for all. So we are having varieties of things available with ambiguity, with obscurity and with skepticism and also with certainty mixed among them, which we have to trace and find out. So this is the blessing of today, and the curse is we have lost the soul of knowledge. We are having the body of knowledge, the ornamental decoration of knowledge, explanations, historical reading, everything is there. Regarding practice, where is the radiation? Who is there to transmit? So there is a paucity in getting the soul of knowledge. The soul of knowledge is available only by the systematic study under the tutelage of an efficient master. So there is a process by which now we have to intermingle, or there must be a process of reconciliation by which the effective method of teaching, that is what we call instruction methodology, effective method of teaching must be revived back by utilizing the blessing of modern sources and removing the curse of lack of soul in wisdom by imparting, by reinstating the ancient methodology of teaching. So the methodology that is available as a technical blessing must be undertaken as a supportive material to the tutelage methodology of our ancient scriptures. Now we are going to take such a subject which is based on occultism. What is occultism? That which is candid and obvious. That is obvious by your experiences, by your inference, analysis and conversant experience and exposure on the surroundings. As well as that which is candid to your limited sense of perceptibility, that is non-occultistic and normal way of education, which is known as the empirical school of thought, by which you learn the concepts, you understand the derivations, then you experiment in a lab and you are getting something which any X with the provided surroundings and stipulations can do at any place to derive the same result. That is known as science. It is known as empiricalism or empiricism. This empiricism, it gives you the idea of a common concept which is eternally relevant and universally applicable, and wherever, irrespective of these people, we can do that. Irrespective of the persons who approach, if the other materials such as the ambience, the conduciveness, the materials required and the various other criteria that molds that thing, that you can utilize here. And occultism deals with something that is far beyond perception. And to put it in a simple example, irrespective of the thing given, where the giver is dominant, that is occultism. Irrespective of the giver, the thing given is valid and effective in normalism or empiricism. For example, if it is H2O and electrolysis, process of electrolysis in integration or disintegration, it can be done by any person. If the process is followed, it will be done. You can get the same result. So, for example, if there is in occultism, somebody is doing, for example, you are going to a doctor. I'll put it in a very simplified example. You are going to a doctor. If there is that medicine which is going to work with you, irrespective of the giver, if the proper medicine is given, you will get a cure. There the thing dominant is the thing given and not the giver. Giver is just a source. And in spiritualism, whether it is mud, whether it is a dry leaf, or patram, pushpam, phalam, toyam, whatever it may be, if it is given by a person who is capable, the dominant is the person given and his influence or transmission, irrespective of the thing given. That is great in occultism. So you have to basically understand that the material capability is more in empiricism, whereas the person who handles that, the person's transcendentality and ability to infuse